To say that there is no evidence to connect Casey Anthony to Kaylee's death ignores all of this evidence.
Mr. Baez, in his closing statement, would have you believe that there must be something wrong with Casey Anthony because she has, quote unquote, imaginary friends. Those weren't imaginary friends. Those were lies.
There's just no conceivable reason why anybody would put duct tape on the face of a dead child. I said it before, people don't make accidents look like murder.
At the end of this case, all you really have to do is ask yourself a simple question. Whose life was better without Kaylee?
Those powerful words still ringing in the ears of the jury as they now decide Casey Anthony's fate. Good afternoon. I'm Martha Sagowski.
I'm Jim Payne. The 12 men and women who sat through 35 days of dramatic testimony are now behind locked doors.
The question remains, guilty or not guilty? Here's a look at the charges they are deliberating. Casey faces a total of 7 charges, including first-degree murder, aggravated child abuse, and aggravated manslaughter.
We have team coverage first at 4. WESH 2 legal analyst Judge O.H. Eaton Jr. standing by to answer your questions. Amanda Ober has more on the end of closing arguments. But first, we get out to Bob Keeling live inside the courthouse, just steps from the jury room. And Bob, what's happening right now?
Well, Jim, the juror seats here in the media room are numbered for a post-verdict press conference if and when that happens. And there's 30 or so reporters here just out of the camera view where we'll get the first word if there's a juror question or perhaps a verdict. Meanwhile, I've seen both sets of lawyers sitting here in the 23rd floor hallway. There's nothing more they can do. Prosecutors sent the jury off with one last powerful message. Casey Anthony is a pathological liar.
Whose life was better?
Prosecutor Linda Drain Burdick wrapped up the state's prosecution of Casey Anthony by ripping into defense claims that investigators lied.
The most well-documented liar ever seen in a courtroom accuses everybody of perjury, of fraud, of lying. The irony is rich indeed.
She drowned at the pool. That's the newest story out there. Surprise, surprise.
Burdick played audio and video from 2008 where Anthony dismisses suggestions that Kaylee's death was an accident. And the prosecutor pointed out why duct tape on her face was the residue of true intentions.
No person would ever make the accidental death of a child look like murder.
Prosecutor Jeff Ashton showed photos of Kaylee's skull to rebut defense claims that the crime scene was staged and gave the jury another look at the grisly images. He showed George Anthony's suicide letter as proof he had no idea how Kaylee died.
This is the cry of a man who just doesn't understand the world anymore. He doesn't understand what happened to his granddaughter. He doesn't understand why his daughter won't tell him.
Burdick scoffed at the notion that Anthony was a good mom and used her first profanity-laced jail phone call home to illustrate her selfishness as family members agonized about Kaylee.
Nobody in my own family is on my side.
Burdick revealed her theory about why Casey abandoned her car near a dumpster, a trash bag still in the trunk.
That trash bag was placed there as a decoy.
And whose life was better without Kaylee? Burdick played one last image, this split screen with Casey partying and her new tattoo, Bella Vita, beautiful life.
There's your answer.
So we're now almost 4 hours into jury deliberations. Again, we're live here on the 23rd floor of the Orange County Courthouse. So far, no word from the jury. Their first job was to pick a foreman today. Now, after the jury filed out at 12:10 to deliberate, I saw George and Cindy Anthony among the last out of the courtroom. And I clearly saw Casey Anthony looking at them, but there was no obvious sign that the Anthonys looked back. There were no last-minute messages to the daughter whose life now hangs in the balance. And we'll be sure and keep you updated if anything changes. Reporting live from inside the Orange County Courthouse on the 23rd floor, I'm Bob Keeling, WESH 2 News.
The prosecution came back this morning ready for rebuttal. The state was fueled by a number of shocking things said during the defense's closing statement yesterday.
And that was to paint Casey Anthony as a slut, as a party girl, as a girl who lies and has absolutely nothing to do with how Kaylee died. And you would dishonor the law and even Kaylee's memory if you were to base your decision on anything but the evidence. And to use emotion to get you angry.
So during an argument where the most well-documented liar ever seen in a courtroom accuses everybody of perjury, of fraud, of lying, the irony is rich indeed.
Fantasy forensics, phantom stickers, phantom stains, all of this nonsense. And no real hard evidence, no DNA, no fingerprints, nothing.
If there's no DNA on the face to which the duct tape was attached, how can there be duct tape, DNA on the duct tape? And they admitted that. That was non-evidence. It didn't mean anything. The defense called 10 other witnesses to basically talk about non-evidence that the witnesses themselves admitted was meaningless. It doesn't mean anything. The fact that there's not dirt on a shoe doesn't mean the shoe wasn't in the place. You know, we could go on and on with that.
And Cindy was swimming the night before. It is extremely reasonable that she could have drowned in the pool. And that's where the state fails. They must rebut each and every reasonable hypothesis of innocence. They cannot rebut this. They can't do it. It's impossible. They can say all they want about chloroform and duct tape and where the duct tape was or where it wasn't, whatever they want. The issue here is, how did she die?
If this truly was an accident in the pool, Kaylee Anthony would have been found floating in the pool, not floating in a swamp down the street.
Our team coverage continues right now with WESH 2's Amanda Ober. And Amanda, the jury has a lot to think about as they make this life or death decision.
They do. And the last they heard before they went into deliberations today was from the state. The state making a very impassioned rebuttal to the defense's closing argument. Now, Jeff Ashton went first, Linda Burdick second. And Jeff Ashton focused heavily on trying to weave together the forensic evidence that they presented and make it less confusing and connect all the dots for the jury. Let's listen as he talks about the duct tape.
In this photograph, you can clearly see that the duct tape wraps around the mandible. It didn't just get washed there by water. It's there because that's where Casey Anthony put it. It's there. The jaw is in place because the tape is there.
Now, Jeff Dean is joining us, and Jeff Ashton did a pretty interesting job of going through all of the forensic evidence, reviewing it for the jury. Was it effective?
Well, for the time they spent on it, I guess it was somewhat effective. But quite frankly, they didn't spend a lot of time talking about their forensic evidence because the truth of the matter is that's the weakest part of their case. This is a circumstantial evidence case. They have issues with these circumstances. They always have. If you hate Casey Anthony, then they want you to convict her. If she's a terrible mom, she cusses a lot, she's not a good person, then you have to believe the forensic evidence. That's the state's case in a nutshell because they don't have the forensic evidence to back up the allegation of first-degree murder. If they did, then the last image you would have seen after Linda Drane Burdick's comments were done would have been something about a lab report or something. They don't have it. And so the weakest part of their case is the part he got up and said first. She followed with a lot of heat.
And she did end with more of an emotional appeal, showing that split-screen photograph of Casey, the party girl, and then the Bella Vita tattoo.
Well, she didn't even mention Dr. Voss, maybe except once when she was sort of outraged by Jose Baez calling him a liar. Linda Drane Burdick had a very honest moment. Her honest moment was what her greatest fear was. And her greatest fear is that this jury won't listen to everything, and they'll focus in on the actual law, which is that nobody can decide this case based on their anger or their emotions or sympathy for anybody. That is her biggest fear, because she spent an hour heating this jury up. She was good television. She was very good television. As a lawyer, I'm not sure she shed much light on anything. And I think that their whole theory has been build up the lies, build up the emotion, and settle for the forensics and then hope for the best.
All right, Jeff. Dean, thank you for joining us. And stay with us, because coming up a little later on WESH 2 News, Jeff will give us some insight into specifically what the jury is doing and maybe experiencing right now while they're in deliberations. Let's go back to the studio.
Amanda, thanks. Our team coverage continues now with WESH 2 legal analyst Judge Joe H. Eaton Jr. Your Honor, we'll go back to the state's rebuttal case this morning. From the bench, did you find it effective?
Well, I thought that both of the arguments were effective. I agree with Jeff that, they're about 80% emotion and 20% evidence, because this is a circumstantial case, and they don't have really strong evidence. But the way it was presented was, I thought, was very effective.
Does the jury go into deliberations with a lot of key questions unanswered?
Oh, yes. There are a lot of key questions unanswered. This jury is going to have a lot of debate among themselves as to just what happened and what's been proven and what hasn't.
Let's talk about these jury deliberations. Talk us through the process that's happening right now behind closed doors.
Well, there's been a lot of study done on how juries decide cases, and one of the things they do, of course, they have to elect a foreman, and they do that. And then generally what they do is they try to come to an agreement about things that they think everybody can agree on. For instance, in this case, they may all just say, well, counts 4 through 7, everybody agrees that, she's a liar, and we'll go with that. And then they get down to the nitty-gritty of the difficult stuff. And they probably will go around the table and let everybody state their views. And then, the jury sometimes call in for an easel, and they write down on the easel the issues they want to discuss and that sort of thing, making lists. They'll go through all of these exhibits, and then they're going to go through these confusing, overlapping jury instructions, and sometimes they really have to pick those apart.
And our viewers have a lot of questions about the charges that Casey faces, and you just alluded to that. There are 7 total. Here's a look at them. Can the jury decide that Casey is guilty of murder but not in first-degree murder? Can she be found guilty of first-degree murder and also aggravated manslaughter?
Yes. No. She can't be found guilty of 2 counts of homicide. First-degree murder in Florida is divided into degrees. First-degree, second-degree, manslaughter, and third-degree felony murder. aggravated manslaughter is a separate crime. Now, the jury can return a verdict of some murder count and also aggravated manslaughter, but the judge can't adjudicate both, because you can't be found guilty of 2 homicides for 1 killing.
All right. Your Honor, some complicated analysis there. We appreciate it very much. Martha?